Alison Gordon from 48 North. Thanks for being here.
Thanks for having me.
It's nice to see you in Las Vegas, where we can advertise cannabis.
Yes, it's so true.
It is. When you land in Las Vegas, really all you see now is cannabis advertising.
I know. I mean, it is wild, truly wild. I can't imagine what it's like for the people that live here.
Well, the sky's not falling.
No, the sky isn't falling here or in Canada either.
I know. So we should have advertising like this.
Jay said it and not me.
Do you think there'll be like honeypot cabs driving in Toronto anytime soon?
No, I do not think there will be honeypot.
But there are a million Planet 13 ones.
You know, but maybe there's too much. I mean, like, as sort of a classy lady, I'd like to see a balance.
Well, class and Las Vegas don't always go hand in hand.
Exactly. So. Well, that's the truth. Like, honestly, you don't see as much advertising of anything anywhere as you do in Las Vegas.
Right.
So
that's
not
right.
Fair comparison.
That's true. But I have noticed that the cannabis advertising has overtaken sort of the gentleman's club advertising.
Yes,
a lot more cannabis than gentlemen's club.
I saw a meme today, like, on the Instagram.
We just call it Insta.
Insta. I'm going to butcher it, but it was something like, it seems like adulting is really on trend for 2020.
Is it?
Yeah.
I think it is too.
Yeah.
I don't know.
So
I don't
like
to think about that.
Yeah. No, the Gentleman's Club. I feel bad. I feel bad for those people.
Really?
No. Obviously not.
It's like, that seems
the
like a weird thing to say.
The sarcasm is there. But you know what's actually interesting? I'm going to change something for you. Do you know that the first year I was here at the MJBiz conference, there was 500 people here?
Jeez. What year was that?
That was 2014.
Yeah. That seems like a long time ago in cannabis industry. That's not like I have.
This is my
I have two kids older than that. Yeah.
Six.
Yeah.
MJBizCon. So you realize it was at the Rio.
Yeah.
And it was, well, I mean, even the second and third year, there was maybe 3,000, 4,000. Yeah. I mean, last year, I think they said 50,000.
Now it's wild here.
And it's like exciting, but at the same time, I used to just stand sort of at the front and it would be like, Alison Gordon, this is your life. And then I knew everybody. And now I look around, I'm like,
it's big.
Do you know who I am?
So thinking about that, what does that mean for the industry?
Right.
Is it becoming more complex? Is it becoming more specialized? Is there still a lot of BS that people won't be here next year? Like, what does that look like to you?
Okay, so I think it means a lot of things. You know me, I'm never going to be short on it. But on the one hand, here's positive and truly positive. The industry's maturing. You look around, there's equipment, automation. Like, these are the things that are necessary for us to really perform as businesses. It's just has not been the case. Like, for example, there is no, to my knowledge, good fully automated pre-roll machine. Pre-rolls are truly the number one seller for us.
Yeah.
And to really get the margin in Canada where we have a difficult time with margin, let's leave it at that, you know, you're going to have to be fully automated. So to come and see the amount of equipment this year and more of that coming, it's maturing and just being treated like any other industry if you would go to food or anything else. So that's great. I think there's still the shenanigans, of course, of promotions and things like that, but like that's what makes this industry fun. I just saw Mike Tyson outside, which is semi-upsetting. And
Yeah.
He's smoking a big joint, people taking photos. It's like,
Yeah, I think that's,
Yeah, let's leave that one.
Let's leave that one where it is.
How are you enjoying? Like, what have you noticed here?
So I've noticed a couple of things. The idea of an industry maturing has come up a lot.
Yeah.
Both from industry maturing because more places are legal, people are learning how to run the businesses at full scale, and sort of a gut punch from the capital markets are making all those things happen faster or more real. And so it's this sort of combination of things where the industry a year from now is going to be different than it is now, and it's going to be real operators doing good work, sort of crushing it, but it's going to be a tough road to get there.
Well, it's a tough road to get there, but with the amount of technology coming in, as I said, like really scale is the issue.
Yeah.
So you had this illegal product for many years, so things weren't grown on scale, they just couldn't be.
Mm-hmm.
So now we're trying to do things at scale without proper equipment to do it at scale.
Or even there's no 100-year history of doing it.
The workforce that's been doing it for 10 years and all of these things. And some of it is just standard. I mean, you're talking about packaging and all this kind of stuff. My chief corporate officer, Charles, who comes from tobacco, is always like, stop saying, well, it's the cannabis industry. He's like, we would go out and spend $10 million on a Slims packing machine only to find out that Slims were now banned.
Right?
Like, it's, you know, and what isn't regulated? Food's regulated. I mean, real estate's regulated, yeah. everything's regulated. So the maturing comes with that is also the recognition that there's no more excuses. The flip side, of course, is when you only have 25 stores in Ontario, it's hard to fully scale on the other side of who you sell to. Yeah. And
well, it's not only just Ontario, because it's like we were talking, I don't remember what it was, but it's like cannabis was legal in Canada, and 60% of the country basically couldn't buy it.
Yeah.
Right? But you look at Ontario, look at Quebec, not that much better. And that is the huge chunk, that's the majority of the population of Canada.
But why are you saying that for Ontario, for example, when they could buy online?
They could, but they're not.
Okay, so it's not an accessibility point. You're saying it's a lack of interest.
It's a lack of retail.
Think retail would change? People don't want to order online.
Whether they do it, they haven't been.
Right.
And I think that's a real problem. It's not they won't, but they don't want to order from the Ontario Cannabis Store. There were problems from the get-go.
Right.
About sort of ordering.
I think they've fixed a lot of those problems.
And people still don't want to buy it online. I mean, I think it's like 75% of the cannabis in Ontario has been sold in the 25 retail shops.
Well, look, I'm looking forward to our market research, because we've been speculating yeah. and everybody's speculating, and it's going to be hard to get some real market research, just because people are still, I think, wary about, yeah. you know, answering your phone and being like, yes, I'll answer 5 questions about my cannabis right. use. But to your point, I think if I'm going to speculate, I would agree that people are confused as it is. If you can walk into a store and speak to a bartender and say, this is what I usually do, or I don't want to be too high, mm-hmm. or I want to get really high, or whatever it is they want, then it's a lot harder online to bring in those yeah. new customers, which I think many, again, speculate will be the majority of legal cannabis customers on the yeah. front end of this.
I do think, though, and I'd love your thoughts about this, we're the cusp of new products being on the store shelves in Ontario, everywhere in Canada, shortly. Let's say January.
Let's say January. I
am of the belief that there will be net new customers that are interested in what's going to be on the shelves that aren't customers now. Do you believe that?
So you're saying no?
No, I believe there are. There are going to be new people that want those products, be they edibles or vape pens or topicals, whatever it is. They want that stuff, but they haven't been buying anything yet.
I agree. I definitely agree that word will spread and people will be excited to try these new products. And the more we can get the message out, we being the LPs, the government, the retailers, to say, hey, like when you buy this edible, what we say is in it is actually in it, and will consistently be like that. I think people will get excited by it. But the challenges are, as you know, with the edible limitations, like it's a challenge for me to envision someone taking the time to drive to a store, wait in a line maybe, there will be less lines obviously, go in and be able to buy 3 10 milligram edibles and that's it. No joint, no nothing.
It's not enough.
A hard,
yeah.
I don't know, what do you think?
Well, just when we were at Planet 13 yesterday, we were 3 people, we probably bought more than that.
No, of course you yeah, did. Yeah. First of all, if you're somebody who takes 30 milligrams, yeah. then
not,
like,
but like
it's...
But you want to try a bunch of different things. You're going to be here for 5 days.
That's the crazy thing. Like, honestly, when I go to LA or here and I go into MedMen or wherever, like, I am spending ridiculous amounts of money yeah. on weed. And I don't seem to think, like, of course I think about it and I'm not thrilled about it, but at the same time I've accepted that this is the cost of accessibility. Yeah. And that's interesting, because in Canada we know that the government's mandate, one of many, is to eradicate the black market. And we seem to all agree that to do that you've got to keep the price low. But yet, yeah. I mean, I don't know.
I think 2020 will be a year where we figure some of these things out. New entrants into the market, new products on the shelves, new retail, certainly in Ontario. I think that's a good combination of things to see an improvement over 2020.
I agree, but I want everyone to still, you know, keep that enthusiasm tempered, only because we know everything. You and I have been doing yeah. this a long time. Yeah. It always takes longer
yes.
than anybody thinks it's going to. And so it will take longer for retail to roll out, for them to understand how to shelve these yep. products that we're talking about. Like, it's just not going to happen overnight. And I think that's one of the mistakes as a business and industry that we've made. Clearly the markets are showing it, which was blue sky excitement. And I think that truly came, at least from my own place, the passion and the amount of work and effort we were putting in seemed to justify what we expected to come out on the other end. How could we totally understand what the rollout might look like for retail or 2.0 products? And so I still think, I agree, 2020, better shift, more coming from the black market.
But still more.
Like, you know, to truly operationalize our businesses and scale, it's, you gotta go through those efficiencies over time.
Well, always words of wisdom, Alison Gordon. Thank you. It's nice. This is the first time we've actually spoken in front of a
Canadian
flag.
Oh, my God. Oh,
like
Canada.
It makes me feel very patriotic, even though I'm not Canadian.
You're not Canadian?
I'm American. What? I know.
When
from Boston. I know. When did this happen?
What?
I know.
Jay?
I know. Don't tell anybody.
But well, you have Canadian citizenship, too.
I am a permanent resident of Canada. I know.
Guys, I'll be taking over as the new Canadian host of
like
the business
it.
Of cannabis.
I like it. If you want to do that, that sounds fine by me.
Smoke a joint later.
I will. Thank you very much for stopping by.
Thank you
as
for
always,
having me.
Always great to talk to you. Look forward to what's ahead in 2020. And
Lots.
We'll catch up with you then.
See you then.
Thanks, Alison.
2020.
Woo-hoo.